the consciousness around Black Lives Matter is really pushing race to the forefront.
Our interconnection with one another, especially as Black people, as the diaspora.
The call for reparations, it's not an anti-white struggle.
We've seen countless horrific deaths, and now people are understanding what Malcolm was talking about. And they're understanding that Malcolm was very much a young, compassionate, responsible man who was seeking solutions.
We want to be recognized and respected as human beings. And we have a motto which tells somewhat how we intend to bring it about. Our motto is, by any means necessary, by whatever means is necessary to bring about complete respect and recognition of the 22 million Black people in America as human beings. That's what we're for. That's what we're dedicated to.
Malcolm X came to visit us here in Ghana in 1964. So these leaders were working together.
For me, really, it's a privilege to be associated with my father's political work.
The call for Africans to rise is not a call against anyone. The call for reparations, it's not an anti-white struggle. Most of us want to see a more just and more humane world. And of course, we need to adapt many of his plans or programs to today's changing circumstances.
I've seen a change of thinking and language by people in mainstream America. The consciousness around Black Lives Matter is really pushing race to the forefront of our political landscape.
Ilyasah, on a more personal note, when Malcolm X, your father, was assassinated, the civil rights movement lost an iconic leader, but you lost a father and your mother had to raise six children on her own. How has that affected you?
I often talk about my mother as a form of inspiration to others because, you know, she lived through her home being firebombed and then a week later witnessing her husband being gunned down in front of her. She never gave in to despair, and she continued to give.
The police and the press tried to make it look like he bombed his own home, which was ridiculous. I mean, he had no insurance on the furniture or himself or anything like that. And now I guess they'll say he shot himself.
That's the thing I noticed about your mom, Ilyasah. I didn't see bitterness. She turned that pain into something where she could inspire generations of young minds. I had a wonderful opportunity to know her mother. Her mother and my mom had a very close bond, friendship, and sisterhood, and kinship because of the common struggle that they went through as women. Who were very much committed to the same struggle and who had to raise children, young children, without their husbands who had been assassinated. I was trying to grapple with, you know, how does someone take my daddy's life like so senselessly when he was just out there trying to make the world better for all people?
I do feel that nonviolent direct action is a most powerful approach in seeking to bring about racial justice.
For me, it did land me at that place of being very angry, hating white people, especially white men. And at one point in my life, I had an intersection with a white man who was interviewing me. And in the middle of it, he said, "Can I hug you?" Now, internally, I was like, no, because I was still at that place of really kind of hating white people, but I knew how to perform otherwise. But when he hugged me, it released something. It began to change my perspective, a past kind of broad stroking, you know, a group of people.
Samia, your father, Kwame Nkrumah, was a great African politician and a man who believed that Pan-Africanism was not just about Africans on the continent, but beyond. Do you feel that his idea of African unity is still alive?
Indeed, it's even more relevant today than it was 50 or 60 years ago, that objective will be arrived at quicker if the 1.5 billion Africans, that is Africans in the continent and Africans in the diaspora, work together.
One of the things that my father wanted to ensure and was very responsible for sharing is our interconnection with one another, especially as Black people, as the diaspora. You know, we had been so divided. We were taught to think that Africa and Africans was a jungle. Instead of realizing that this is where we came from, we did have a history and we did have an identity, and that that identity was rich and worthy of learning and acknowledging.